High above the ancient mining community of Saint-Aine in the French Pyrenees lies a bowl carved by the glaciers of the Ice Age. It is the collecting point for the streams that drain the mountain frontier with Spain. Here, in 1925, a hydroelectric company planned an ambitious scheme to convert the energy of these streams to electrical power. There was just one baffling problem. A major stream, the Albe, disappeared into the ground far above the collecting reservoir. Colouring its water with green fluorescein dye showed that the Albe re-emerged too far down the valley for the project to work. The engineers spent 7 years searching for the lost river. In 1932, when all else had failed, they made one last attempt to salvage the scheme. They called in a young French cave expert. His name was Nobert Casteret.
So the task was more difficult because both disappearance and resurgence were impossible. But I know and love caverns, abysses and subterranean rivers. Studying and exploring them has been my life's work. Therefore, although the conditions were most discouraging, I took them as a personal challenge. My first step was to look at the resurgence where the green dye had reappeared. Alas, when I reached the little torrent, I had to bow to the facts. Not only was the resurgence impenetrable, but the whole stream went entirely out of sight under an enormous heap of debris, which blocked the ravine for 100 yards. In my disgust, I saw nothing better to do than to take the water temperature above and below the wretched landslide. The thermometer showed a drop of 2 degrees centigrade between the 2 points. This was proof of an underground stream's arrival.
The dye test and Casteret's own temperature tests proved beyond doubt that this was the point where the water of the Albe re-emerged into the daylight. But to trace the stream's passage to a point above the collecting reservoir, Casteret would first have to find a way into its underground watercourse.
I stuck my pick in the ground, dropped my knapsack on the grass, and sat down to look at the splendid cliff which towered above me. Suddenly, I noticed a black hole in the wall. I had seen it from afar and had taken it for one of the many mine tunnels of the neighborhood. Now I saw that the hole was too big and irregular for a man's handiwork. It must be a grotto, or at least a natural porch. I came for it at once. I can never leave the slightest cavern uninspected. I thought of all the disappointments of the past and of all the false grottos that lead nowhere. I heard the familiar sound of distant running water. I knew I had providentially discovered the torrent I was looking for. Excited and impatient as I was, I had to be careful. The candlelight was bad, and the slope grew steeper and steeper. And then I saw it, whirling over its gravel bed, and rushing with vile, sucking noises into a fissure.
Voilà.
I was thunderstruck at the sudden vastness of the cavern. My dancing candle flame showed confused mounds of earth, and then a pitch-black void. I hurled stones as far and as high as I could, but I heard them fall without hitting walls or ceiling. No solitude is comparable to the bowels of the earth, no night so dark as the blackness underground. I was walking in a nightmare. I would gladly spend days alone underground, but only when I know the topography and can keep in touch with something palpable such as a wall. Here, I had nothing, and each step took me further into a void from which I might never return. I faced about and made instinctively for the stream. Once I found it, I followed its winding course, vicariatne with her thread. After traveling what I took to be a little over half a mile, I reached a point where the roof of the cavern sank until it touched the water. It was a siphon. My usual method of attack in such cases, by diving, was useless here. I was so tired and nervous, and my light was so poor, that I decided to go back and put off the rest of the exploration to the following day.
The next day, Casteret returned, accompanied by a group of engineers who worked on the hydroelectric scheme. Novices all to the mysteries of caving.
The solitude and mystery of yesterday had given way to high spirits. The men were gay and excited over the new sport. Where I had dared the black silence, in fear and trembling, we splashed and shouted noisily, and the lamps sparkled in the water. The spell of the cavern was broken. Here, the more delicate members of the party emptied their shoes and dried their clothes while I reconnoitered the way ahead.
Et vous autres, par ici, ça continue.
Coagulated surface spread out before us. It was terminated by high cliffs, also white. Nowhere but underground could we have seen such a spectacle. The walls were covered with a dull, granular deposit, deceptively like the side of an ice floe. We walk through an Arctic wilderness.
Regardez.
The unreal diffuse light of our lamps seem like that of the midnight sun. Amid all these wonders, we advanced but slowly. We could not avoid trampling on flowers, crushing masses of crystal with our hobnailed boots. Constant new splendors kept us breathless. The least of them would have been the crown jewel of any cavern open to visitors. Stalactites and crystals sparkled everywhere. Their profusion, their whiteness, their shapes were fantastic beyond belief. We were inside a precious stone. It was a palace of crystal, but that is a mere cliché for what we saw. Even in coloring and delicacy, the formation surpassed the most gorgeous flowers of nature. Immediately afterwards, as if the grotto had used up every possible formation, all display suddenly stopped. I dragged along, flat on my stomach, between floor and roof. With great difficulty, I gained a few yards. I stretched out my arm, and found I could poke the lamp through on its side. In this position, I tried to look ahead.
Sentez-vous ce courant d'air?
I was excited to see the lantern flicker in a cold air current which blew in my face, proving that the cavern went on.
Un fort courant d'air souffle ici.
Unfortunately, ill-equipped as we were, there was no getting through. During the long winter evenings, my thoughts turned to the great cavern. In my imagination, I saw its flashing stalactites plunged again in gloom after our furtive passage. All the useless splendor seen but once in centuries of centuries. And often indeed, I dreamed of the final crack. No cavern had ever taken such a hold on my imagination. I was burning to continue the exploration.
Prenez garde à notre photophore.
This time, I had the company of two miners, who soon opened up the wind hole with crowbars.
Je continue.
Luckily, it was not a long conduit, but simply a hole opening into the roof of a huge hole. At the bottom, 40 feet below, was the underground stream again. We went down a narrow pitch to the brook, which we tried to follow on narrow overhanging ledges. Suddenly, one of these cornices gave way beneath me. This gave me one advantage over my companions. I had no further need to keep dry. In any case, it soon became impossible to go on without taking to the water. So, leaving my companions, I set out alone to see what lay ahead. In a few strides, I reached the middle of a pool below a waterfall which fell noisily from a height of 30 feet. The wall from which it fell was absolutely smooth and perpendicular. The obstacle was insuperable. Still, the day had been a success behind our dreams, for we had found the torrent again and made several hundred yards. Before I was out of the cavern, I had formed a new plan of attack. We had with us 5 pieces of iron pipe. Each was a little over 6 feet long. They could be screwed end to end, forming a long rod.
Précaution, messieurs. Ces cristallisations sont fragiles.
Pipes were heavy and clumsy enough anyway, and moving them was doubly hard because of the precaution necessary to prevent puttering the threads. Struggles in getting them through the water, the rock piles and the low tunnels may be imagined. I walked with lowered head into the water spout, blindly seized the pipe with both hands, and swarmed with all my might up this new form of greased wall. The icy downpour soaked me through in a twinkling and hammered savagely at my back and shoulders. I could not even climb so fast as I would have liked, because I had to keep an eye on the balance of the pipe, which threatened to slide off. The further I climbed, the less violent the waterfall, but the more flexible the pipe. I had but one thought, to climb up where I could breathe. Suddenly my hands hit the upper edge of the cliff, and my head popped out of the water. This was a crucial moment, for I had to hoist myself, get my balance, and let go of the pipe. That I should reconnoitre alone once I got to the top of the cascade. I scaled 2 new cascades, but 500 feet upstream from my companions, I reached a deep basin. The temperature of the water that day was only just above freezing, and a new bath was anything but tempting. I was frozen and worn out. After 5 hours struggling in the water, my hands were rigid. The cold water and the accumulated difficulties were too much for me. I had to turn back.
above, where the stream drops through fissures in the limestone to begin its underground journey, there might just be a way in to the upper end of the system. If Casteret could find such an entrance, it would enable him to pursue the Alb on its downward course toward the Cigalere, following the route sculpted by the water through millennia past. Casteret spent days scouring the area for an entrance, but in vain. The cracks were too tight to allow the passage of a human body.
C'est donc ici que se perd la rivière.
Obliged to press on with his exploration from the resurgence, Casteret returned to climb the fourth cascade and to discover three more. But the seventh cascade demanded new techniques.
On this expedition, I was accompanied by my friend and colleague, Max Cousin, and my Spanish assistant, Vasquez. We were still carrying the same kind of metal poles that we had used before, but with a snap hook at the top to which a ladder might be attached. At the seventh cascade, we fixed a pole, and I and Vasquez went ahead. Cousin was to follow behind. But while climbing up, a hook on his boot caught in the cable of the ladder. Suspended by 1 foot beneath the cataract, he was indeed fortunate to escape more serious mishap. This curious accident quite took it out of Cousin. We left him behind to recover while we explored ahead. I arrived with Vasquez at a new waterfall, the 8th. We had only a few sections of pole left, which was quite inadequate as this new cascade was 45 feet high. We raised the column against the cliff, a feat of strength accomplished not without alarming bumps and much trembling for the joints. I sought to test the precarious balance of this assembly. Then, for want of a better means of ascent, I set out to scale the cascade as best I could. I made my way up, part by the ladder, part by gaining purchase against the cliff itself. Whilst my companion watched anxiously, I reached the end of the iron pole. I took a grip on the rough edges of the wet rock, a sort of crumbling shell, and made an extremely dangerous ascent over this very insecure rock face to the summit. I pressed on upstream, splashing through swirling pools, drawn by the roaring of another cataract, which I soon glimpsed in the shadows ahead. What I saw made me turn back straight away. This ninth waterfall rolls down a menacing black wall for 50 feet. This time I knew we were beaten. I therefore gave up the Cigalere cavern and decided one last time to see what I could find high above, near the disappearance of the turret. One day, I was making the rounds of a series of these funnels. Happening to look down one smaller than the rest, I saw a black hole big enough to let a man in, with a thin mist rising from it to show its great depth. Against such a discovery, I had brought along my outfit for preliminary work. I slid through the narrow opening of the chasm. Now for the simple trick of my trade. The paper spiraled down, lighting a bell-shaped chamber. I slid down to the bottom, 60 feet below ground. Underground, the sense of hearing is almost one's chief reliance. Nothing could have pleased and excited me more than the mournful plaint which rose to my ears. There was a sighing and wailing amplified by echoes. The voice of the Alp torrent.
But Casteret would need help if he was to chart the course of the underground river further. On his earlier trip, he had followed the Alb for 500 feet in its downward plunge toward the cavern of the Cigalere. At that point, he had been stopped at the brink of an enormous shaft, an obstacle too great to tackle alone. It was to descend this that he and his assistants now returned.
Leaving early in the morning, we had climbed under crushing loads to the mouth of the funnel. Then the painful descent of 500 feet with repeated wetting taxed us severely. For want of ladders, absolutely indispensable for such work, I had planned to be let down on a rope.
Comme convenu, un coup, vous m'arrêtez. Le coup, vous remontez.
Bien, monsieur.
Allez!
Lâchez, désiré, lâchez.
Le voyez-vous, monsieur?
I slid over the brink of the abyss as far as possible from the cataract, and my assistants let me down rapidly, hand over hand.
De la bataille, monsieur. Bonjour.
At a depth of 60 feet, I managed to kick down a big stone, which fell with the whistle of a cannonball. The rope would not reach that far, so I gave the signal for the hoist to begin. Desperate effort, I managed to swing towards the wall, and I dangled again at the end of my line. I heard anguished voices. In every nerve, I felt the frightful tension of the rope. Slowly, very slowly, I went up by short, feeble tugs, but I went up. One last yank, and I sprawled over the edge, landing on my knees at the feet of my exhausted saviors.
Ah, bravo, monsieur. J'aime plus. Je ne vous tirerai jamais, monsieur. Jamais, monsieur.
A careful survey of the new cave revealed how close it lay to the cliff outside. And in this was the solution to the hydroelectric company's problem. A short tunnel driven in towards the cave would divert the Alb back to the surface within easy reach of the collecting reservoir and the turbines of the power plant. The diversion of the Alb freed the great shaft of its pounding waterfall. Casteret's task was finished, but he returned to continue the descent and reach a depth of 979 feet. The Gouffre Martel, named in honor of the great pioneer Edouard Martel, was the deepest cave in France. And yet, The connection which Casteret sought with the Cigalere still eluded him. Perched 4,000 feet above the valley, the ruins of the mining camp at Bontayou stand mournful witness to an industry forsaken by the economics of the modern world. There is little to attract the casual tourist to this desolate spot. But for one small group of people, Bontayou is a place of annual pilgrimage. Among them, this year, is cameraman Sid Peru.
It was very much the books of Casteret that I read as a teenager that inspired me to start caving, and particularly the book about the Cigalere. So when I got to start making films about caves, then it was an obvious choice to actually try and make a film about the Cigalere. But that wasn't easy. It took us something like a year to get permission. And when we got that permission, it was on the condition that we would be the only people allowed ever again to film in the secret chambers of the Cigalere. And that gave us a tremendous sense of responsibility, because it meant it was a once and forever opportunity, and we had to get it right first time.
Straddling the crest of the high mountain ridge, exposed to all the vagaries of the capricious Pyrenean climate, the derelict mining camp seems an unlikely and forbidding destination. But its location, atop the cliff that guards the entrance of the Cigalere, makes it the ideal base for exploration in the cave. At Bontayou, their hosts, the Archal Spilio Club of Paris, await them.
Hello!
Set up by agreement with the French government and the local community, Archal are the guardians of the Cigalere's priceless treasures. Each year they return for 1 month only to continue the work which Casteret began. Their first task is to reopen the cave.
It's inevitable that it was going to have to be gated in some way. And although many people will be horrified at seeing a cave which is locked up and in fact welded closed for 11/12 of the year, when you begin to learn just what's happened to the Cigalere since those days when Casteret made those beautiful discoveries, you begin to realise why and what a problem it actually poses.
As Casteret himself recorded on his return to the Cigalere after the Second World War,
"My Cigalere was no longer recognizable. Everything had been pillaged, kidnapped, razed. It was defiled with the name of the Germans from the occupying forces. The Cigalere was no more."
But despite the chagrin and anguish which Casteret suffered on his return, the Cigalere still contains formations unsurpassed in the subterranean world. And it is to preserve these that security measures are necessary. These formations escape destruction because they exist in an obscure part of the cave. Beautiful as these formations are, it is cameraman Sid Peru's lifelong ambition to film those in the fabled seventh heaven, the most secret chamber of all. At Bontayou, the Archal team plan their program of work. There is much to be done during the single month in which they have access to the cave. Passages discovered in previous years must be surveyed, new finds logged and evaluated. But most important of all is the continuing process of exploration. Due to the restricted time available, Archal must choose carefully where to concentrate their efforts if they are to succeed in their search for further discoveries. Since the 1930s, many new passages have been found. After the war, Belgian cavers scaled the ninth cascade to reach an impossible siphon beyond the 26th. But one great mystery remains. Where is the link with the martel which Casteret sought years before? For the explorers of Archal, it is still a tremendous challenge. First, the equipment for the push, scaling poles similar to those first used by Casteret, must be carried to the site that offers the best prospects for a breakthrough. Fourth cascade, a ladder from the ceiling leads to a traverse in the rift above the stream. Easier to negotiate than the waterfalls, the high-level traverses still demand the utmost care. The eighth cascade was difficult for Casteret. It is no easier today. Above, there is a small hole in the wall of the shaft where water, possibly from the martel, enters the cave. Beside it, a rock ledge. By climbing the ladder which is suspended from the top of the scaling pole, the cavers hope to reach the ledge and investigate the inlet. The nature of the rock, a soft and rotten shale, makes it impossible to climb by more conventional means. This, together with the instability of the pole, combines to make it a hazardous undertaking. One member of the Achal group was seriously injured here by falling rock the year before. It took his rescuers 2 days to bring him to the surface. The ledge, some 3 tons of rock, has collapsed, narrowly missing the cavers beneath. It seems the push won't go. As the weather closes over Bontayou, everyone is aware of what could happen in the Cigalere below. In heavy rainfall, the stream in the great chamber behind the entrance swells to become a lake. If the rain continues, the lake rises to seal off the cave. No one can get in, and anyone inside could die before the flood recedes. But the waiting cannot go on indefinitely.
The water level may fall, but it's not possible for us to stay here for more than 2 weeks. When it rains like this, the lake behind the entrance fills quickly and blocks the cave, which could mean us having to wait for more than 2 weeks for it to drain to a safe level. If we get a heavy storm that lasts for a couple of hours, it could block the cave for up to 3 weeks.
And for Sid Peru, that would be disastrous.
Well, the problem is that when this rain started, we were not even nearly finished the filming schedule. And we've obviously got to play safe. We can't get into the cave at the moment. You've got to remember that back in the 50s, there was a Belgian caver killed in just these sort of circumstances, trying to get out of the cave in a flood. The French have only got these 2 weeks when they can be here, and there's no way that we can actually go in and film without them here. And as yet, they haven't even told us where the secret chambers with the formations are. So, fundamentally, with the rain continuing and the French maybe going home, the whole film project could fall apart.
But that is not to be. The local weather patterns, fickle as ever, surprise everyone as the sun breaks through to dispel the gloom at Bontayou. An exploratory trip confirms the water level in the cave is safe, and an Archal team prepares for a second attempt on the link with the Martel. Waterproof clothing replaces the coarse cotton boiler suits of Casteret's day. Sophisticated multi-fuel lamps, the makeshift lanterns of yesteryear. Their objective this time is a huge shaft where water from the Martel is known to enter the Cigalere. To reach it, they traverse high above the first cascade. Their only handholds are the brittle incrustations of gypsum on the weak shale bedrock beneath. One slip here would be fatal. At the inlet, the leader uses techniques more familiar to mountaineers than cavers. He inches his way across crumbling ledges of shale, glued as if by magic to the overhanging wall. The shaft converges to a rift above. Beyond, the climber shouts he can see an opening.
C'est bon, Jean Raval? C'est bon, là?
But the consequences of a false move now are unthinkable.
tout dans la boue encore.
On their way out, they report their discoveries.
It's gone very well. We crossed above the shaft of the Martel Inlet and found 300 meters of big, wide passage, which leads to an enormous chamber. There are many other passages, but we had to come back because our lamps were running low. Of course, some important questions still need answering. Next year we'll make a map of the new passage and then we'll know exactly where we're going.
The trip to the seventh heaven is on. Sid Peru and the film crew will be guided there by Dr. Mongan, a geologist of the National Institute for Speleological Research.
I mean, it's fantastic to think that after all this time we're eventually going to be shown where the seventh heaven is, because way back during the rain and so on, we thought that we just weren't going to get there. So to actually know that we're now going to be on our way is a real sense of euphoria, because we've dreamt about it and thought about it for over a year now.
Of course, not only can't we tell where the seventh heaven is, but we had to be very careful with the shots that we did of us en route to the seventh heaven to not actually give anybody an idea where the place was, because like everybody else, we are sworn to secrecy.
Camera. Batteries.
Right, let's try your light on, Curtie. Can you hold it up a bit higher, a bit closer? That's it. Nice, now your light, John Gibb. Beautiful. Right, okay.
We started filming in the entrance passage to Seventh Heaven. That was already very beautiful. But before we were allowed to enter Seventh Heaven itself, we were going to have to take off our boots and all our muddy overgarments, even our helmets, to minimise the damage that we could cause. It's the only time that I've known cavers to go to quite such extremes to avoid damage. I think I've never been anywhere that was so delicate and with such a variation of forms as you see in the seventh heaven. You get the feeling that if you breathe heavily, things will start falling around your head. Everything is so fragile and at the same time so stunningly beautiful and pure. This is one of the few places I know of where there are the three basic crystals of aragonite, gypsum and calcite all together on the one formation, plus many other minerals which are introduced in various odd forms. So you get an infinite variety of shapes, and the appearance is almost like snow crystals rather than rock formations.
A mysterious glint of gold suddenly catches their eye. Revealed for the first time in the Cigalere by the glare of the film lights, this small group of formations with their glittering crystals of iron pyrites is of a type found only once before in the world.
On the floor, you will have something that looks like a pile of needles of glass. Each one may be a foot long and just a fraction of a millimeter thick. And they're just laid there like, almost like a pile of cotton wool. On the walls, you will have a variety of forms from gypsum flowers to large winding fingers of aragonite. You felt tremendously privileged to actually be able to stand in a place like that, because the fact is that there can only be a certain number of people that can ever see that place in the near pristine condition that it is now. I think anybody that's seen Seventh Heaven can understand that anything other than secrecy is going to lead ultimately to the very quick destruction of this place by people that are less careful than many of the people that have been in so far. I would hate to think that in 10 years' time, in 15 years' time, that that is going to look the same way that the passages in the entrance series look now. Anybody that's seen it must realise that the Cigalere is uniquely precious. But I can't help wondering whether locking it away behind iron doors is the complete answer. Because after all, has beauty got any value if nobody's allowed to see it?